everybody. How's everybody doing? My name is Jerome Jennings. I'm here speaking with Sam Turvey and Erika Elliott, Executive Artistic Director of SummerStage. And Sam Turvey is one of the creators of the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival, started in 1993. I just want to get right into it, Sam. You've been you're a humongous jazz fan. You've done so much in helping propel its visibility in and out of New York City. Can you talk about how that all began and some of your people who were involved in that undertaking?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I'm glad you said use the word fan. I'm an advancing amateur, and I do what I can. I don't take myself that seriously, but I am an attorney, and I've always been public spirited oriented, and I managed as a young attorney to be on the board of the Manor House Jazz Workshops, which is an educational institution up in East Harlem that's been there for some time. Gloria Denard was its founder, Kenwood Denard, her son, I'm sure you know since you're a drummer. And at a time when a school teacher in the East Village named Chantal Lend had been petitioning for years to name a section of Avenue B after Charlie Parker, since he lived there for a few years, important years towards the end of his life, she wanted to rename the street Charlie Parker Place, and had been having trouble getting people to embrace that. A council member came in named Antonio Pagan. He said, good idea. Members of his staff, a woman named Ann Hay, said, why don't we do a festival at the same time? And a bunch of us who'd been involved in the neighborhood collaborated, and with the help of a woman named Judy Sneed, who was connected in the jazz community, sort of collected, you know, probably our initial budget was 15 to 20 grand, and we put together an event in honor of Charlie Parker, and it took off right from the start. And one of the reasons was that you know, as a musician, that the rest of us aspire to, he really is such an important influence to the musicians. And they were so pleased to see that somebody was paying that level of respect to him, that the first year we had Hank Jones, Jackie McLean, Roy Haynes, any number of other people. At one point, Hank Jones, Jackie McLean were on the bandstand and there wasn't a drummer. And somebody says, is there a drummer in the house? And Billy Higgins jumped up onto the stage. And then they had Roy Hargrove sit in. And, Red Rodney played that year, and Sheila Jordan and others. I hate to miss anyone, but it took off. It immediately took off in New York. It got good press out of the gate. And the musicians respected that weren't full of ourselves. It was about putting this event on and really trying to celebrate Charlie Parker in the right way. And I have continued to do different charitable ventures, but that one I said, this one I really want to dig in on. This is really positive on so many fronts. We want to keep going towards that. And the only other person I'd mention, any number I could, but we ultimately became a not-for-profit. But for our first few years, we operated through the not-for-profit that was the Committee on Poetry, Inc., which was Allen Ginsberg's poetry project. He had been a friend of my father's in college. While we never met, he knew of me, I knew of him. And that was very helpful for us to get that level of administration out of the way. And when he died, we actually did a nice tribute to him at the festival. So I could carry on forever, but that's sort of the start.
Yeah, I mean, and of course, for those of you who are listening and don't know, Thompson Park is very important. It's a very important landmark to have the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival there, because he lived right around the park. He lived at 151 Avenue B from like 1950 to 54, I believe. And to have that festival there, I think is an amazing, amazing thing. And I think it pays fantastic tribute to Mr. Parker. Now, Erika, you have booked so many amazing shows, and there's a misconception inside of the music world and outside that Summer Stage is just a Central Park thing. Speak to that.
Well, I hope it's not too much of a misconception because we've been working really hard.
Not as much as it used to be.
Right, right. I mean, when I started with the organization over 15 years ago, we were really centered on our landmark main stage, which is in the heart of Central Park and a beloved institution and location. And of course, Central Park is known around the world as a destination. But consistently over the last 15 years, we really wanted to amplify the work that we do outside of Central Park. And that's really about connecting arts and culture with communities around the five boroughs and making sure that arts are accessible to all New Yorkers. And that's really the mission of the organization, is to, you know, bring arts to community and make it barrier free with no admission. So we are in all five boroughs. And of course, Charlie Parker Jazz Festival is an extension of that. I mean, we'll probably touch on it, but the organization absorbed the festival before I joined the organization, and see it as an extension of our summer stage. And of course, it's in Harlem with our Uptown edition, and then down in the East Village where it was originally started by Sam and his colleagues. So we're all around New York City proudly, and feel that we're a distinctly New York festival for that reason.
Now, Sam, this is a question for Sam and Erika, both you both. How did it come about that, you know, Charlie Parker Festival mashed up with SummerStage? How did that happen?
Ooh, well,
I said I was a fan before, and it was a group of local folks, volunteers, Howard Hemsley, Ann Hayes, Susan Vaughn, Judy Sneed, and then some people more in the musical community, Sandy Jackson, Milt's wife, and Sarah Morgan, and some others, I'll forget. But we did this for 10 years, and we flirted with trying to do more to institutionalize it or look for somebody to take this over in the industry, not for profit or otherwise. This was a great accident that came upon us, and we were putting on these amazing shows with anybody who played or recorded with Charlie Parker in the last, who was still alive during that period. We presented, perhaps with the exception of Sonny Rollins, but it was getting to be about 500 hours a year of work for me. My kids were getting older. We were searching for a successor. And then 9/11 happened, which was really sad because one of our really best shows happened the week before, and it was just a terrible juxtaposition, and money dried up and things started getting a little cranky and contentious on our board. And we decided, hey, look, 10 years and out isn't a bad thing. And we paid our dues, and we tried to find the right successor, but we couldn't. So no sooner had we declared that we were going to go out of business, I got a call from Liam Cavanaugh at the Parks Department on behalf of Adrian Benepi and the SummerStage people. And it was it's one of those welcome calls in life. We said, hey, Sam, we'd like to succeed to your festival. It's going to keep going on. And he said to me, and I never forget, he said, you know, Sam, we were just waiting for you to get tired. We've seen this movie before. Somebody like you comes in and does something like this, great, and then it needs to get legs, and would you be willing for us to do this? And there was one other suitor who was also an excellent suitor, but they didn't quite have, I thought, the staying power of SummerStage, and did a lot of research, and at the time, a woman named Alexa Birdsong, who not only had a name that's perfect for a Charlie Parker Jazz Festival, but had more jazz chops than I ever had, although I did a pretty good job. My board and I met, and we were like, what's not to like about this? The Parks Department is filled with jazz heads, and they were very, very committed to keeping these two programs in these parks, and were not in a sycophantic way, but very solicited of us. They said all the right things, and we were tired and very happy to know the show would go on, because there are a lot of people in New York who, they really wait for that festival every summer, and it was really great for that to be able to keep on. And Eric was a little further down the road, but the experience with Parks and SummerStage has been terrific.
Yeah, I'm so glad you brought up Alexa, because she really was the visionary. I mean, obviously, as a woman who was part long time with, you know, New Orleans Jazz Festival, and really a visionary in that space, to have her take this on. And then actually, just to give her credit, she also was the one who made the decision that it was really important that we do Harlem, you know, as an important landmark destination, and Marcus Garvey Park in particular. So that was her leadership and vision, and, you know, couldn't be happier, was happy to work for her, but definitely want to give her credit here.
Yeah, she was terrific. And I mean, among the things that she and only she could pull off. She had, I think it was Abby Lincoln booked both at Marcus Garvey and at Tompkins Square Park, and Abby got sick. So because of Alexa's connections, on about 20 seconds notice, she got Cassandra Wilson to do both shows. I would not have been able to do that.
Mm. I think that's amazing. Now we're talking about, we spoke earlier, Erika, and you spoke about the 20-year mark.
Sure.
So
yes. So I'm cutting you off. Go ahead.
No. But how is that? Just so the audience members know where we were getting at. Like, you were talking about how that 20-year mark was very important. How is that so?
Well, I mean, any festival that reaches 20 years is a huge achievement and landmark and a testament to its staying power and a lot of hard work on the part of many individuals. But what was important for me at that moment is it was another singular moment where we made strategic decisions around expansion. And so, you know, we'd had this great legacy. And certainly at that point, we'd already had what we called sort of the Uptown Edition and the Downtown Edition. But at the 20th, we also made a conscious decision to expand further. And what that meant for us is the current format, even at that time and to this day, is artists doing basically 30 to 45 minute sets, maybe an hour, and doing them, you know, at the hour in the 4 hours. So you usually get four artists on the Saturday and four artists on the Sunday. And, you know, given those limitations of time and stuff, you couldn't really do big band projects or commissions that were expansive in terms of the amount of players. So we decided for the anniversary to expand into the Friday night. So the festival had historically been Sunday, we'd added the Saturday, and then we expanded further to have the Friday night and built that as a platform for commissions and big band projects. And so that first year we commissioned Jimmy Heath, rest in peace, to do a piece that he had earlier been commissioned for, but for big band. And so that was a decision. And then we also really wanted to expand and create other opportunities in the neighborhoods where the festival takes place. So Lower East Side and Harlem, to really, you know, celebrate the people that are working year round in jazz and the larger story around those communities and their connection to the genre. So we do everything from family workshops to, we obviously work with the National Jazz Museum and have had them as a great partner over the last few years, to do lectures and workshops and movie screenings and master classes and any number of things, to really just take the opportunity to celebrate jazz more broadly and Charlie Parker wherever possible, in the neighborhoods where jazz really was such an important influence. So, yeah.
Have you all moved out to Brooklyn? Have you done a bunch of stuff in Brooklyn yet? Or?
We have not in jazz. Okay. I mean, we do shows, of course, in Brooklyn, and we certainly have presented some jazz musicians in Brooklyn. In fact, we did Theo Kroeger a couple years ago. But in terms of Charlie Parker, we really stay true to those two neighborhoods as being sort of where we're rooted and where the festival took place and started, and then expanded into Harlem for all the reasons that are obvious, but not formally expanded, no, not into Brooklyn.
Now, Erika, you spoke about legacy. I want to ask you a question, Sam. Now, you're looking at, you're getting up in almost 30 years of a festival that you were ready to almost head out after 10 years because of, you know, various situations. But 30 years, we're talking about a legacy here. How have you seen this Charlie Parker Jazz Festival leave its imprint in NYC as far as the jazz, the culture of the music in New York City? What have you seen?
I think what I would say is, look, you know, jazz is a collective improvisation. So myself, James Burke, Erika, Alexa, Adrian Benepi, a whole host of different people have contributed to making this thing, as Alexa Birdsong said to me, this thing was a home run from the moment it launched. Unfortunately, we've been generally blessed with really good weather. But I would say, as a legacy, New York City really is the jazz capital of the world. No place has 40 jazz performances going on a night, and I probably understate it. But with the 25th anniversary, the Times did their picks, and they said approaching 25 years and nearing perfection. And I think everybody who's dealt with this festival has wanted to do right by the excellence of Charlie Parker's music, and you know, somebody who didn't get the chance to live to see his legacy fully take bloom, and we all take that very, very seriously, whether it's the critics covering it, sponsors, et cetera. So it's just been one big positive. And I've said, you know, Erika is not a chatterbox. I am. She lets me speak at this thing, even though I haven't done it for 20 years. You know, I when I get on the stage at the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival and either Marcus Garvey or Tompkins Square Park, I don't think New York City reveals itself more beautifully than it does on that day. And at the 25th anniversary, I spoke at Marcus Garvey, and it was a few weeks after Heather Heyer had been killed in Charlottesville. And, you know, that new Marcus Garvey band shell space is so beautiful. And I looked to the audience, I said, turn around and look at each other. There are probably 160 nationalities or races in the audience, and that is probably undercounting as well. And just in a beautiful Saturday afternoon, enjoying this music of this great musician, and in that historic neighborhood where the Great Day in Harlem photo had been taken a few blocks north, and there's so much history in the park. And it is just a very perfect thing in New York City. And your friend Phil Shapton said something really nice to me after I left the festival, because I had my own level of postpartum depression about that. He said, Sam, this festival has come as close to a perfect outdoor experience in New York City. And he compared us, he said, the only thing he thought was in our league was Joseph Papp's Shakespeare in the Park. Now, Bill can be a little enthusiastic about anything named after Charlie Parker, but just being mentioned in the same breath was great for me. And Erika and the team at SummerStage have just continued and expanded this in a way that's really terrific. And it's part of our brand. It's a benchmark for New York City as far as I'm concerned.
I have to correct myself and jump in, because I think your memory is better than mine. I think the expansion that I talked about may have been the 25th anniversary, but I'll leave that to the fact checkers to define. But there was a big anniversary. I don't mean to overstep my place, but I cannot say how much of a joy this festival is to present, for all the reasons that you just said, Sam. Because of course I present Central Park. I mean, that's a joy in itself, and the life that we bring to that park through music. But Charlie Parker Jazz Festival is something else. It's just really, really special. And you feel that. And you feel that with the elders that are dancing in the front rows. You feel that, you know, in the audience being diverse of age, of you know, gender, of color, of every kind of mix of New Yorker from every walk of life is there. And they're all welcome, and they're all vibing to the music. And it's there for everyone. And that's something that in music is so important, that a lot of the work that we touch on at SummerStage really is about, is just making art available to people, because it is such a life-affirming and important thing. So,
yeah, I think it's an amazing thing, Erika. And to play it is very electric. Sam, to play in Thompson Park is very electric. You're on stage and you can actually see birds at old crib from the stage. It's like, it's amazing to be there. SummerStage, it's amazing to be, I mean, Central Park is just completely electric. You know, I wanted to also talk about this particular moment in terms of COVID first. So much of the culture of how things are presented, performances and lectures and teaching, it's so different now. How are you all dealing with this particular moment? We're in quarantine, and I mean, we're looking at over 4 months at this point. How are you all dealing with this and programming?
Well, programming on a personal level, obviously it's a crazy time for everyone. And that's why we're on a Zoom having this conversation instead of in person, right? So I think it's an amazing testament to human resiliency. And it's been very hard for everyone on every level. And it's a trauma that who knows what the long-term ramifications are, whether you're talking about jazz clubs surviving and arts institutions, or us as humans evolving. But I like to keep it positive, and I think we are resilient. And to that point, I mean, as an organization, we had a choice to make. I mean, we had the entire festival booked. We were ready to announce, and then COVID, right? So we have made a conscious decision to continue to put great art out in the world and to continue on presenting artists and supporting artists by paying them, which of course right now is a critical issue for working musicians. And everything that we've done since has been digital programming and content, you know, including conversations like this, and there are many others. Everything can be seen via our social channels and also on our YouTube. You can go back and watch things if you missed at the time that we aired. So in an effort to really continue, like I say, and just continue to move forward, a lot of amazing programs. I couldn't be prouder. Certainly things that celebrate jazz, but obviously all the other great genres and disciplines that we do every summer. So from dance to hip hop to Latin and everything in between. And it's been great. And I hope people will view not only what they're tuned into now, but please, you know, check us out on YouTube and see all the great performances.
Yes. How about you, Sam? And do you, with the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival in this COVID moment?
Well, I'm a professor emeritus of the festival, so I'm not formally involved, although, you know, Erika and her team do solicit my ideas and actually take some of them, and I'm always appreciative for that. They treat me terrifically. I am on the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, and we do partner with Erika's team, and we are trying to present streamed music and pay musicians and do what we can. I think we've all got to try to be extremely creative, not to just give up, but to try and keep both the art moving and the economy moving. And so things like that are what we're doing, and trying to be creative every day. And just personally, if I'm in a local business and there's, you know, a $13 bill and I have a $20, I say keep the change. I know that may seem like nothing, but, and the people would never want to keep the change. And I said, hey, you got to stay in business. We all got to keep this thing alive, because this is really an awful situation that we've all got to get through. And for the musicians, you know, we're very conscious that it's just a disaster.
Yeah. Now another ongoing moment that has pretty much exploded in the proverbial Uncle Sam's face is what's happening with this, with the racial tension that's going on with George Floyd, Sandra Bland years ago, Breonna Taylor. Now, Charlie Parker, he's an innovative musician, but he also is one of the musicians who spearheaded a very radical movement. Bebop, called bebop, is very radical. Is there anything that you all are how is this, if it is at all, informing the way you move forward at this particular time of upheaval? Anything?
Well, I often talked about and looked historically at the interrelationship between jazz and what was going on, and I can read a quote from Duke Ellington in a minute, but from Billie Holiday's Strange Fruit to Nina Simone's Mississippi Goddamn to some things that Max Roach and many others have done. But frankly, when I read the Ellington quote, he basically says it's really pervasive in the music. But I think, you know, there are different things a person on my side of the racial divide can do. I found my strength by accident was in promoting African-American culture, and doing the best I could within my own limitations to see that move forward. And so, you know, I think there's so much in the music that speaks to what's going on. And I think John Lewis is, I'm not sure whether his funeral is on as we speak or not, but the other thing that I mentioned before I read the Ellington quote is, you know, in 1963, Martin Luther King gave that wonderful speech, and Americans don't like to remember that 3 weeks later, a terrorist act, well on a par of what happened to George Floyd happened when they blew up those girls in that church in Birmingham, Alabama. And when I talk about jazz, I talk about that. That's sort of a really ugly and amazing thing. And I'm impressed with Martin Luther King in so many ways, but I can't imagine going from the soaring heights of that Wednesday speech and going into the White House with his coterie that included John Lewis, and then having to give eulogies 3 weeks later. That took a lot of courage to have to speak to those parents and to try and keep it together. I can barely keep it together as I speak about it now, but I would encourage anyone who hasn't listened to John Coltrane's Alabama, which is an elegy about that, to listen to that. And let me just read this quote from Duke Ellington, because he's sort of an elder statesman of the music, but I think what he said here is relevant today as when he wrote it. He says, "My men and my race are the inspiration of my work. I try to catch the character and mood and feeling of my people. The music of my race is something more than the American idiom. It is the result of our transplantation to American soil and was our reaction in plantation days to the life we lived. What we could not say openly, we expressed in music. The characteristic melancholic music of my race has been forged from the very white heat of our sorrows and from our gropings. I think the music of my race is something that is going to live, something which posterity will honor in a higher sense than merely that of the music of the ballroom." And that thinking, I think, permeates so much of what I look at when I listen to jazz or think about it. And there's a quote in the New York Times the day after King gave the speech, and they talked about the melodic and melancholic chords that his speaking pattern spoke to. And as I said to you and Erika before this, I consider Martin Luther King one of the great improvisers in African-American history, in that while he wasn't a musician, his wife was. He improvised the I Have a Dream speech. In the middle of it, he stops. You can see a documentary. He looks up and changes the text and went back to a speech he'd given in Detroit in the spring at C.L. Franklin's church. And so that's really one of the greatest improvisations in history. And he certainly was very aware of and tuned into the experience of the jazz musicians, and, you know, was very close, I believe, with Billy Strayhorn. And so this intersection has been there from the start, but I digress.
You should
go with it.
No, you know, Sam, I think that quote is amazing. I also think it's important to mention that through that black aesthetic, improvisation has always been there, whether we're talking about a West African kora player, whether we're talking about a great orator in Martin Luther King, in Malcolm X, in Ida B. Wells, in Ella Baker. They're going to be speaking and going off the cuff. That's just what happens. That's what we do. So I think to make that connection between Martin Luther King and a great tenor saxophonist in John Coltrane, I think it's there. It's pertinent, and I think it's timely as well. I also feel your sentiment of Martin Luther King having to eulogize those four little girls. Days after his speech on Washington, I think it's very timely. But I like to bring it back to the present, whereas we have a president in Obama who he was kind of on his way out of office when 12-year-old Tamir Rice was killed in Cleveland, Ohio. That was that bittersweet moment of us having our first African American president, yet having so many African Americans killed on his dime, or during his time as presidency. But I also want to talk with you, Erika, about this particular moment and Black Lives Matter and how this specific movement to our time and as Americans, Black Lives Matter, it looks so different than any movement we've ever seen. How is SummerStage? How are we dealing with that?
I don't know. It's hard to speak on behalf of a whole festival, but I can talk about my thoughts just having heard both of what you said. I mean, I think for one, obviously, the injustice and the murder and the system that has been working, it's not that the system isn't working. The system is working really well. And people are tired and things need to change. And, you know, it's hard to listen to Sam talk about all of those stories of the past in the 60s, way before I was born, and say, well, yeah, but look at Breonna Taylor, look at Tamir Rice, look at everything that continues to happen. And of course, now we have social media. So of course the stories are amplified in a way potentially and visible in a way potentially than they ever have been able to be told. But those injustices are the fabric of this country. And we are having a reckoning, and we should, and it's overdue. That doesn't speak to the festival, but I will say, you know, I think the role of musicians is to tell that story and to speak that truth. And they have always done that, and they continue to do that. and I see my role as a festival producer to give platform and to give artists a chance to tell their story, because it is the most authentic expression of any moment in time. So I think that's a big part of the way that we run this festival and the way we curate. If you look at the way we book, we are presenting by far more Black and Indigenous and POC humans who are amazing every single summer. And we're glad to do it because we are representative, and I feel a personal obligation to this city to be reflective of the city. And so it needs to be diverse and it needs to include all voices. So I'm extremely proud of that. And I do believe that is my legacy at the festival, like giving platform to artists of a variety of perspectives. And as it relates to Charlie Parker specifically and this festival, again, you know, really giving platform and giving a space for this music and particularly this community to be celebrated and amplified and tell the story of not just the past, but this moment. I try to imagine all of the amazing art that will come out of this time that will be hard and will be emotional and will be powerful, but will also reflect, you know, the times that we're living. I think that's what art does. So, you know, I don't know if that answers the question.
No,
but,
that's fantastic.
That's sort of, yeah, how I feel at this moment.
Can I sneak one in, Jerome? I know I carry on, but
no, carry on, Sam. Carry on.
Well, look, one thing I was proud of, I forget which year it was, but it was the 100th year since Paul Robeson's birth. And, you know, unfortunately, there were aspects of his politics that caused him not to be celebrated the way he should be. But we did do a Paul Robeson tribute in Tompkins Square Park, and we did tie it into Bird. So it was only about 10 to 15 minutes, but some of his family came, and Howard Hemsley, our CAO, gave a speech about him. But there were, and one of my biggest misgivings about the festival or things I wish could have happened differently happened, but so we had three parts of the musical presentation. We played Paul Robeson on our sound system. We had a very good sound system. And it's always fun to watch somebody who's never heard Paul Robeson sing, hear him for the first time on a sunny Sunday afternoon when it's 74 degrees in New York City. But the first number we did was Waterboy. There had been a fundraiser for a communist council member from Harlem. I think his name was Davis, maybe Benjamin Davis. Phil Schaap will know. And Robeson gave this stirring rendition of Waterboy, and Charlie Parker ran on stage and handed him a glass of water. That's sort of Charlie's obtuse and incomprehensible sense of humor. But then we also tried to, and it didn't quite work, have Al Gray play Motherless Child on a plunger mute trombone with Cyrus Chestnut on piano. Cyrus got stuck in traffic. Al was happy to do the solo anyway. When Cyrus got there, Cyrus did the piano with a little of Al behind him. I really wish I could have got them to do it together and really replicate Paul Robeson. But the last song we did was Deep River, and probably my proudest moment in the festival was one of Paul Robeson's nephews spoke, and he said to the audience, he said, "I don't know who picked Deep River." He said, "But that recording, you should know, most of you think about him for Old Man River, but Deep River," he said, "that's what we played at his funeral. That recording is what we played at his funeral." So I didn't know that. I picked it out, and you can imagine I'm the accidental festival producer. I was pretty happy to hear him saying that. And it was a nice event. And Johnny Gary from Jazzmobile was our stage manager. He also helped bring the concert to Harlem in the first 3 years. It would call Johnny
hey,
Gary.
Thank you for bringing him up. I forgot to mention him. Such an important player
okay.
in all of this.
We're improvising. We're all in different
yes,
places.
Yes.
But I would be remiss if I didn't mention Johnny Gary. There are quite a few people uptown who would let me have it. So, but Johnny was just wonderful. And that in particular, he had been at some performances of Paul Robeson, and he just sort of, he would chuckle and make fun of me as things were over. And he said, "Sam, I don't know where you came up with that, but it worked." So onward.
That's amazing. So Sam, you're not right, man. Cause I was going to ask a question that you kind of got into, but I'm gonna let Erika answer it first. Now we're talking about almost 30 years of music annually. I know this is a tough question, but is there any memorable moment, any memorable performance, any memorable backstage happenings that went down during this time that you can think of off the top?
I want to start by saying the best part of the festival is sort of the backstage hang. right?
Yeah.
Is all the musicians with such deep love and respect for each other. You know, almost, you know, not a singular moment of any two people interacting, but just that general feeling, whether you're uptown or downtown, of all of the musicians being in the same place in New York. There is a special vibe to that. And it happens every year, and it feels sort of like a homecoming moment, or sort of like almost like a family reunion vibe. And I deeply appreciate that. You know, in my time, there've been so many and so many discoveries. I mean, I'm particularly proud of sort of the next generation of young players. We usually try and book it from, you know, contemporaries of Parker. So like a Roy Haynes, of course, I always think of his performance when we presented him, which was in Marcus Garvey Park, and the energy, I mean, and the vitality in that man, dancing around on the stage post-performance, and just everything that he brings to life, is always inspiring. But some of the younger players that we've had as well, the Corey Henry set was powerful. You know, Camille Thurman, I think, is, I mean, there's been so many, Tia Fuller, and I'm really excited about those folks. For me personally, the one story is of Jose James, who I've been a fan of his entire career, and at the time that we presented him at Charlie Parker Jazz, he really wasn't, you know, positioned as a jazz musician per se. He was really positioned more as a soul music singer. And I knew he had it in him, and I adored his voice, and I asked him, and he was like, of course I can do a jazz set that's, you know, appropriate for this festival. And he did. And it definitely was a pivotal moment in his career. So I always like to think of the artists that hopefully have been impacted in a positive way by my ability to give them that platform. So I'll call him out, and maybe, God, there's so, I mean, God, I could go on and on and on. There's so many, but maybe I'll add in, Sheila Jordan is just a gem of a human, and it's always amazing to have her. And maybe Gregory Porter, just cause he's a personal favorite. We had him at Tompkins Square Park. But there's too many to mention in an hour. So yeah, I could go on and on.
You got one, Sam?
Well, let me go on only a little. I promise I'll be crisper than before. Look, I live in Madison, New Jersey, where Shanghai Jazz is, and Gary Bartz was there one night. I said, Gary, you know, we just do this once a year. I produce every festival like it's going to be my last. He said, you should, because we play every note like it's going to be our last. But I would say that Etta Jones, far and away, was the most popular performer we had with the audiences and with the musicians. There's jazz, as you know, is a community, and everybody loved Etta. So whatever she did was a complete home run. But I would say the marriages of Milt and Sandy Jackson and Jim and Mona Heath were an inspiration to me to watch backstage year in and year out, and the way they took care of each other and looked after each other. And one year Milt played with Ray Brown, and he played in a sentimental mood, and Milt would hit that one note in the intro to a song and hold it and let the reverb go out, and watching that wash all over the whole audience was unbelievable. And then just the last one I'll say, Hank Jones, I think I said to you earlier, did a solo at the end of our third show. He played The Very Thought of You in that very high register, very beautifully, very humbly. He said, nobody wants to hear from me. But when we got off stage, he, of course, had a jacket and tie on in the summer and a hat. I'm goofball. They'd been playing basketball and was so inspired by Hank. He came over sweaty, messy, Larry Bird jersey on down to his knees, big white Converse sneaker up on those black London-style walls of Tompkins Square Park. And he's really insisting that Hank sign his sneaker and telling him with his messy hair how much he just grooved on it and couldn't believe it. And Hank had this sardonic, wry little way to him. He's like, well, certainly, so appreciate your coming and speaking to me about this. And you could tell he wasn't angry. Hank loved people. But he had that funny way that anybody listening to him could tell. He was like, what planet are you on asking me to sign this grimy sneaker? But he did it, and there were many, many, many moments about that. So I'm going to have to write a book someday.
I think that's amazing. I think also we should give props to NYC Parks for hosting these fantastic shows, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, they've been a strong partner from the beginning. I mean, our organization works in partnership with them, and certainly they continue to be supportive of everything we do around this festival and more largely throughout the city. The City Parks Foundation, who I work for, couldn't do what we do without the support of the Parks Department. Mitchell Silver, the current commissioner, is amazing and really loves what we do. But these public offerings would not happen if Parks Department didn't believe that arts and culture were really critical and the best use of our public spaces. So yes, thank you for calling that out, because they deserve the recognition as well.
Yeah. So I would like to just ask you, Erika, maybe in closing, unless you all want to, we can keep going if you all want to, but I wanted to know, where can people go to find out what's happening, since much of the festivals, we don't have any outdoor festivals happening right now.
Sadly, you know, this has been a really hard year, and certainly for live music. So, I mean, conversations like this, which, you know, I'm so thankful for everyone who's tuning in. Thank you. Certainly get into the chat if there's questions after this. We're happy to stay on and answer via chat anything that we didn't answer in the conversation. Please, again, follow us on our socials. A lot of this is about really making sure we're better connected with our communities, all of our communities, particularly the jazz community and others. So if you don't already follow us on Instagram or Facebook, please do that. And then at your leisure, go to YouTube. All of what we're doing is archived there. So lots of great conversations have already taken place. Sheila Jordan and Christian McBride did a great talk. Miguel Atwood Ferguson, we were able to share his Bird with Strings performance as well as a Q&A with Ashley Kahn and Miguel about their process and Bird and all things jazz. So take a look there. And then if you can and are interested, tune in next week, Shabaka Hutchins. And then, you know, stay tuned. We'll definitely have some stuff coming up in the fall. We'll definitely be presenting something around Charlie Parker's birthday that weekend. So more on that soon. Just stay connected with us.
All right. And Sam, I've been meaning to ask you, you know, at the end of Charlie Parker's life, he stated in an interview that he wanted to study composition abroad. Do you all plan on expanding this Charlie Parker Jazz Festival
abroad, or to including commissions? What's the question?
Expanding.
Listen, the reality, one of the silver linings of doing this digitally is that not only these conversations can be had on site or in the institutions around this New York City in person, but now this conversation that even we're having right now can be viewed around the world. And that is a great gift to the global community, so that we're creating not only in real life, but also anyone can access this music and content and conversation. In terms of in real life presenting concerts, my first dream and wish is to get back to business in New York, and that's really what we're about, being rooted in New York. So I don't think any plans to do that anywhere else anytime soon. Really, frankly, the organization is about New York City and making sure that New Yorkers have access to arts and culture, and that we celebrate the unique genres and communities that have birthed music that is now celebrated around the world. So we want to make sure New Yorkers still are able to be part of that and see that every year.
I could give you a two-prong answer to that. One is to throw some props to Erika. On the composition point, and you raise a very interesting thing. While some critics and others suggested that Charlie Parker with Strings was a commercial enterprise, actually Charlie Parker absolutely adored putting that record together. And there's not an alto player alive who doesn't want to record with strings since that recording happened. But I think it was under your watch, it might have been under James' watch, Erika, but there was an Italian saxophone player who came in. The first half of the show, or the second half of the show, was Charlie Parker with strings. And I think the first half was some modern compositions. Kenny Garrett at NJ Pack did a show, I think half was Bird with Strings, half was some classical compositions. It may have been you or James or Alexa hired Jimmy Heath to do a Charlie Parker composition. Yeah. I mean, you've been very, very good at doing those sort of things. So while Erika focuses on New York City, which she should, and I've lived and worked in every borough, I cheated. I was born on Staten Island. But what I would say is the National Jazz Museum in Harlem is exploring doing more things overseas. But the one thing I would say about these sort of things, you have to be careful about expansion. This festival is one of the few festivals named after a jazz musician that's really true to its roots in the same way the Thelonious Monk Piano Competition is. A lot of time these things happen, they grow, and the next thing you know, they're presenting artists that aren't jazz artists, and jazz becomes the warm-up band. And you got to be careful about it. It's hard enough to keep these things alive, and the Parks Department has done a great job through thick and thin of it, as did I, in keeping hope alive after 9/11 for one more year so they could grab the baton and save me from myself. But I think certainly compositional work the Summer Stage people have been doing for years, and we are doing some of that at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, and we're exploring doing some things overseas as well.
I think that's amazing, and I hear you, Sam. Sometimes when things expand, it kind of adds a bit of water to the coffee.
The idea that this thing is going strong 30 years later, I wouldn't have predicted that in year 7, 8, and 9. So I'm.
And if you look around the festival world, you know, aside from Newport or something, I mean, there are not that many that have been around for this long. So it is a real testament to the power of this city, the artists behind it, the visionaries who started it, and really the city itself.
So you're staying true to the city. I think that's amazing. Amazing. So, I mean, I think I'm gonna wrap this discussion up. We've gotten a lot of information from Sam Turvey, Erika Elliott. Sam Turvey, a member of the founding group of the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival, held in Thompson Square, jazz aficionado, jazz fan. Erika Elliott, man, she visionary. City Parks Foundation Summer Program, Performing Arts Series, Summer Stage, and talent buyer. And now we are here to talk about how this thing is moving forward. We've completed our discussion. If there's any closing words that you all would like to say?
That's a tall order. We've covered a lot of things. I know we have a little more time. I would love to hear Jerome, you know, being a drummer yourself. I'm going to turn the table, right? Okay, you're a musician. You've played the festival. You're a drummer in your own right. Tell us some of your fondest memories. I know you've both played and been audience at the festival, but whether a singular show or what impact you think the festival overall has to the jazz community as a player. Tell me a little bit about what you think the impact the festival has made to the musician community.
Well, that's interesting, Erika. I mean, when you travel and play, I'm a drummer, that's what I do. One of the things that I do, and when you travel the world, there's festivals that are named and clubs that are named after these great iconic musicians. There's a club called the Dolphin for Eric Dolphy in Japan. There's the Montreal Jazz Festival, of course. There's the North Sea Jazz Festival. But when you actually play a festival that's literally on the ground that the person it's named after and the iconic musician that we all have to listen to be able to deal with the music, actually walked that street or hung out in that park. You know, at some point, Charlie Parker was there. It's another kind of spiritual experience, you know, as it's playing it in the Vanguard. It's another kind of experience when you're on that stage. And Sam, I think it's very important that the audience know that the first people who were booked for this festival actually shared the stage with Charlie Parker. Charlie Parker called Hank Jones to play with him. He called Roy Haynes to play with him. You know, Max Roach, Roy Porter, Roy Haynes, and he's still alive, playing his butt off. I think it holds a lot of weight. It holds a lot of merit, authenticity. My time, I played the festival with Craig Handy and Second Line Smith. That was a fantastic moment because, you know, they walked on stage from the crowd. I'm not sure how many times that has happened,
I think that may be the only time.
So I think that's a fantastic, it's a fantastic thing. I'm hearing you, Sam, you're talking about how, you know, Paul Robeson was played over the loudspeaker, which kind of, I don't know, was that at Marcus Garvey or was that at Thompson?
Tompkins Square Park, I think it was 1998.
Okay, so he hadn't made it to Marcus Garvey yet. So, I mean, it's important because, I mean, that almost like predates, it's almost like foreshadowing because, you know, he was a humongous figure, him and his wife, Islanda, were humongous figures, important figures in the Harlem Renaissance. So to, you know, making those kind of connections are very, it's very important to me and to be a part of something that is making those kind of connections. This is that happened decades ago. And now we can talk about it in this particular moment in history where those kind of things are being staged. But you sincerely wanted to hear Paul Robeson's voice and you knew how important he was to the culture. And I think that's a beautiful thing, Sam, Erika. I think it's a beautiful thing that the name Summer Stage Everywhere. When did that happen? I'm sorry, I'm going into a question again. When did that happen? Summer Stage Everywhere.
Well, it's Summer Stage Anywhere.
Just anywhere. I'm sorry.
To be defined, but
anywhere. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, it's a reflection of this moment. I mean, to just simply say that we're doing Summer Stage Festival digital, it didn't, you know, we felt like we had to reflect in a name what this moment and pivoting online was going to be about. And the idea is that we can now be anywhere and to kind of look at the positive piece of it. And so we can't be Summer Stage in your neighborhood park or in Marcus Garvey or Tompkins or many of the parks that, or any of the parks, frankly, that we normally are physically in, but we can be anywhere. Via digital. So that really is just a brand new way of approaching the work that literally is happening real time now. We did our first shows in June. So it's really reflective of this current period of quarantine and COVID and began in June. And it will run through likely the end of year, if not beyond, because of course, once you've made the turn to start to have these conversations and present things online, you don't want to just stop, right? Have to figure out how to do that when we are back to doing regular business and back in real life in front of audiences. But the hope is that this will only complement and give us yet another way to bring this content and conversation and context to the work, and that can be seen anywhere in the world. I want to make a suggestion, Sam. I want to repurpose your brilliant idea of Paul Robeson, and I think we do need to air something next year when we're back in business in Marcus Garvey Park. So, you know, you heard it here first. Let's try and do
please
something.
Please get a great piano player and a trombone.
Well, we got to figure out who and how, right?
It really did break my heart because Cyrus is so terrific and Al was a very enthusiastic performer at the festival. But yeah. Can I go to Eric Dolphy, Jerome?
Oh, please. Yeah.
So this one, you say, what should people do? What should be thinking about the music? Keep exploring it. So I'm going to give you two recordings. We would play recordings from people who passed that year. And one person who had passed, I believe 2000, it was probably the first or second year we did Marcus Garvey, was Ken McIntyre, McKenna Ken McIntyre. His son is now on the board at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. He has a record with a piece called Diana on it, and Eric Dolphy plays bass clarinet. It's one of the greatest jazz tracks I think there is. It's not as well known as it should be. I think the record is Destination Out. It's not really an out piece. It's a very, very, very beautiful piece. And then a shorter piece, more nuanced, I'll show that I am an advancing fan, the Julius Hemphill Sextet. I believe it's called At Dr. King's Table, the Children's Song. At Dr. King's Table is probably the name of the album. It's only about a minute and a half. I asked Marty Ehrlich to play it at the festival, but she said, Sam, we have some other things we have to play. That's okay, Marty, it's your gig. But the more people know that, if somebody was asking me to program John Lewis's funeral, I would play that. It is a very beautiful piece of music. And that is what makes this music fun. Your learning never has to stop. And I would say another thing. When I started the festival, there are two kinds of people. There are people who Charlie Parker is a badge of elitism and how they distinguish themselves from others. And there are not many of them, but I sure don't like any of them. It's not me. I found the musicians at that festival and the people that I associated with and Eric were inclusive and fun and not judgmental. and the more you wanted to give to the music, they would take. But my definition of a jazz musician is somebody who gives more than he ever gets in return, and you need to respect that. And that's how I went about program. It's how anything I've ever seen Erika and James and Alexa do things. And that's a spirit that can sustain a city. It's just one small chapter and two or three days in August, but it's important. Every day needs to count, and we've all worked hard to make those days count.
Can I raise a question too? I mean, we're going to wrap up soon, but it's been really, really important. One of the things we lost by not being able to present the festival this year is the ability to celebrate Parker's centennial birthday. So of course, we've been trying to elevate that story that he would have been 100 years this year. And so maybe if you guys would, I mean, I have my thoughts, but maybe if either of you could talk about why we should really be celebrating Bird in 2020. And why is he still relevant? Why is this important? Why are we talking about Charlie Parker 100 years later? And maybe that's a good way to end our conversation. So Sam or Jerome,
I'll let Jerome handle that one.
Well, I think it's important for us to revisit Charlie Parker and us to revisit him in a different kind of light, I think. I know that we like to speak on the nose about his playing, which it's innovative. It's you know, it's something that many musicians have been chasing to this day, to be able to accomplish his spontaneity, his prowess, his technical prowess on the instrument, his jovialness. But I think we should check out the moment in which Charlie Parker lived. Now, 1943, that was a tumultuous time in New York City. There was a riot. In Harlem, a serviceman was killed, right? So I want us to look at how his environment helped to inform his artistry and inform where he was and why he did some of the things that he did. And I think we can do that by illuminating artists that are of this particular moment, right? And I think me and Erika, we spoke about this earlier today, and tokenism can kind of hurt the music more than it can help it. And I think when we talk about this movement, bebop, I think we need to speak about the community in which spawned that particular movement and not iconic person or two persons. I think it's important for us to move past that in the spirit of Black Lives Matter. I think that would service the movement. I think it would give more than just lip service to it. In the classroom, outside the classroom, in festivals, behind the scenes, in front of the scenes, bookings, managers, in every way.
I don't know, Sam, if you have anything to add, but I couldn't add anything more to that. I think
no, I think I don't fully understand. I don't fully understand the energy that he generates among the musical community. I experience that it as a very positive force, and Erika and I and any of us have done this, have seen this with the musicians. It's part of the success of this festival, the respect that it gets because of who it's named after. And certainly studying the context of his time, I think would be really, really wonderful, including his influence on the arts in general. I mean, there are Allen Ginsberg quotes about him, Jack Kerouac quotes about him, Frank McCourt, the school teacher who wrote Tiz from Stuyvesant High School, said he doesn't care whether he goes to heaven as long as wherever he goes, he can sit next to Billy and Bird. I mean, there's a wonderful tapestry that can emerge from this. And yeah, Jerome, we should all keep at it. And I can just tell you from personal experience, it's a lot of fun and it makes life worth living. It is the gift that keeps on giving.
Wow. On that note.
Yes.
Sam Turvey. On behalf of Sam Turvey, Erika Elliott, thank you all for tuning in. I want to thank Sam and Erika for being here. thank you for your insight. And I think it's very important for us to get an insight on how the festivals, what happens behind the scenes, and the parks that put these festivals on and give that, that gives space for these things to happen, and the people who are behind it, people like Sam Turvey and Erika Elliott. Thank you all so much for being here.
Shout out to our SummerStage staff. The whole staff always contributes. I want to say hi to Paula Abreu, who obviously is the backbone with me and leads a lot of this programming. So I don't want her to not be visible in this, because it obviously always takes a village, whether we're talking our production team, certainly the booking vision is there, but without everyone, you know, like anything in life, without a village, nothing can really happen. So thanks to everyone. And thanks so much for everyone who tuned in. Please continue to watch what we're doing at SummerStage Anywhere.
Absolutely. And thanks for the Jazz Museum in Harlem, Ryan Mahoney, Lauren Schoenberg, that village that you're talking about, Erika. Gotta shout them out.
Yep.